verses 6 to 8. And subsequently after that is from verses 19 to 28. John chapter 1, verse 6. God sent a man, John the Baptist, to tell about the light so that everyone might believe because of his testimony. John himself was not the light. He was simply a witness to tell about the light. Verse 19. This was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders sent priests and temple assistants from Jerusalem to ask John, "Who are you?" He came right out and said, "I am not the Messiah." "Well then, who are you?" they asked. "Are you Elijah?" "No," he replied. "Are you the prophet we are expecting?" "No." "Then who are you? We need an answer for those who sent us. What do you have to say about yourself?" John replied in the words of the prophet Isaiah, "I am a voice shouting in the wilderness, 'Clear the way for the Lord's coming.'" Then the Pharisees who had been sent asked him, "If you aren't the Messiah or Elijah or the prophet, what right do you have to baptize?" John told them, "I baptize with water, but right here in the crowd is someone you do not recognize. Though his ministry follows mine, I'm not even worthy to be his slave and untie the straps of his sandal." This encounter took place in Bethany, at an area east of the Jordan River where John was baptizing. This is the word of the Lord. Why don't you turn around to the person next to you and just share with them the peace of the Lord? You can say, "The peace of the Lord be with you," and the other person can also respond, "And also with you." Please be seated if you're done. Don't just stand. Good morning to everyone. Reason why I'm standing up here today is because Pastor Augustine, in his infinite wisdom, hopefully led by the Lord somehow, decided to institute some sort of a lay preaching program in our church. So some of us have been, the right word is called, the more appropriate word has been inducted or forced, to be scheduled onto a regular timetable to basically just give you some other voices to listen to besides Augustine. And somehow in the Lord's humor, he left us without adult supervision today. Pastor Augustine is actually away at another church conducting service, so we're left to do whatever we want to do. Yay! My wife was suggesting we all play bingo, and then when we're done, we just go home. And I'll just hand out sermon notes, whatever it is, you just repeat off those points, and then we'll say we did what we're supposed to do. Unfortunately, guilt keeps me in line, so I have to share with you some sort of message. I'm sorry, I'm very self-deprecating when I'm nervous. So anyway, I'd just like to share with you some thoughts and reflections over the scripture readings that we've had today. We normally follow, for those of you who are new or with us for some of the first few times, we actually follow the lectionary. And the lectionary actually prescribes certain readings throughout the year so that eventually, if you've been around long enough, you would have heard the entire Bible being read. And it's a very good discipline, I find, because then it forces people who have to share thoughts and meditations like me not to just skip out and decide what we want to share, but it forces us to discipline and together as a church, as we go through the worship and as we go through the readings, all together we come and encounter God. So with that, would you just join me for a quick word of prayer before we begin? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for Advent. We thank you, Lord, that in this season, even though it may be perceived slightly differently by others, we thank you, Lord, that the season is among us. Even though for some it is the sale of the year, for some it's the decorations in the mall. But for us, oh Lord, you remind us, these little glimpses of the season add to that feeling, Lord, that Christmas is coming. And as we celebrate Christmas, as we celebrate the season together, Lord, we anticipate we hope. We look forward to a time with family. We look forward to presents and gifts. But in the midst of all that, Lord, help us to look to hope for you. Help us to find glimpses of grace in the days of our everyday living. And most of all, Lord, as much as we hope that other people would get the true reason for the season, I pray that you make that reason for the season, Lord, that your reality, that your revelation will be made fresh in our lives again each step as we take towards the Christmas season, as we celebrate Christmas, Lord. So we thank you, Lord. We pray for ears to hear, open hearts, and for myself, Lord, truly let me get out of the way of what you want to do and help me just speak words that you can use, Lord. And that together, Father, we will hear from you what you have to say and walk ever closer with you and towards you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The readings, when I went through all four readings, and the theme that came out to me was actually one of hope. As you heard the Old Testament reading, it was from Isaiah. It talked about how, you know, the year of the Lord and the proclamation of the year of the Lord, we're here to proclaim good news, freedom to the captives, binding of the brokenhearted, and so on and so forth. And then when you go on towards the New Testament, you also hear things like Paul's epistle, where it talks about how we are able to pray unceasingly, we're able to rejoice always. And right in the middle of it is the gospel, where we hear about John the Baptist. And John the Baptist, his calling was a very, very interesting calling. As I was doing some of the readings behind it, it's very, very interesting. Let me take you to the first point. A lot about hope, right? Wow, my slides are badly designed. Sorry about that. The missing word is hope. Actually, that's very poignant. The missing word in our lives sometimes seems to be hope. It seems very, very tough to be hopeful these days. I mean, if you think about it, in the next slide. Oh, there we go. You have all these reasons, all these realities facing us. You have a recently concluded General Assembly that was full of love and joy and caring and sharing for communities all over the world. You also have what some people are lamenting to be the death of democracy with the recent passing of the Peaceful Assembly Act bills and all sorts of other things that, for some, people would consider to be very, very wrong with our government. You have slightly more down-to-earth, I would say, kinds of heart-to-heart issues that parents are facing. The teaching of math and science in English has been recently repealed this year, and I think parents were really, really driving forward and were thinking about the future of their children's education and what that meant for the country and all these other things. This year also, I think some of us know that last box there, it's one of the most horrifying things I've ever seen in my life. It is truly terrible. You all look like you don't know what I'm talking about. Okay, for those of you who are not very aware of that video, it is basically a video clip of a street camera that in China, basically what had happened was this little girl was crossing the street and a truck, basically ran into her. And the horrifying part was that it ran into her, stopped for a little while, and you could tell that the driver was deciding, what should I do now? And for whatever reason, there's a whole lot of continued writings after that in editorials and stuff. But for whatever reason, that driver decided that he was going to drive off. So he drove off, and the little girl was actually in the middle of his truck, so he actually rolled over her a second time. If that wasn't bad enough, that little girl lay there for, I don't know, a good, 45 minutes, an hour or so, and there were like loads of people walking by. They actually passed by and they saw, and then some crossed the street and walked on the other side. Some walked over the body. And this little girl was not dead, by the way. She was moaning, she was groaning in pain, and she was bleeding. No one stopped until 45 minutes later, an hour later, somebody who was in a shop nearby came out and, you know, realized that this little girl was hit and then called for help. There's no happy ending to this story. The little girl eventually succumbed to her injuries and passed away. And it was a huge moral outcry a huge time of self-reflection, especially for the Chinese people, because they had become that kind of person. There was a lot of talk about how in the pursuit of success, in the pursuit of wealth and prosperity, they could not even find time to stop for a little girl who was run over by a lorry. And I mean, it can go on and on. But anyway, basically, that was truly one of the most horrifying, disturbing clips I've ever watched. It's very bad. I did not try to watch it until our national news decided to play it on TV as well. And that just made it worse. So anyway, you have this scenario this past year. If you move on, you also have continued stress. We're looking at a rising cost of living. I think some of us have tried to measure our paycheck for this year and anticipating the increases for next year and wondering how we're going to cope. We are overwhelmed with work. For those of you who may know, I actually just started a new job recently and I'm like up to here in work, and it's been overwhelming. There's actually an internal cultural phrase where they say we're drinking out of the fire hose, as though it's so funny. But yeah, some people actually take pride in the fact that, oh yeah, we're in this high performance culture, so you've got to learn to live with it. Then you have bills and debts, and especially the Christmas season, now we're thinking of who to buy presents for and how much to afford and all these other things, and the pain will come January, if not February, after Chinese New Year. And I feel like that guy Ray at the end there. I'm all Christmased out. It's not Christmas yet, but I'm all Christmased out. Yesterday, I had the joy of driving to Wan Utama during one of their massive events. They're having a huge, I don't know what it was, but it was massive. And parking was a joy to go through. But I had to go because we were doing caroling at MPH. And I'm like, wow, you know, just driving through, finally arrived there. I'm all frazzled, you know, kids were slightly going bonkers at the back. And it's not even Christmas yet. I am all bonkered out. I'm just so exhausted. And that's the situation we're in. We are often put our nose, we often end up putting our nose to the grindstone and we are stuck. And we are, we as though we can't move. And as we look down, what I'm realizing is that this Christmas season, as much as we sing about things like hope and joy, the missing word seems to be hope. I think many of us have that issue, that we're facing it. So if we read the scriptures, so you feel like that. I feel like that. I don't know about you, but I do. The next slide. Is this the season? What season is this for? Next slide. Isaiah tells us the year of the Lord's favor. This is what Advent is supposed to be about, the coming of the Lord, the second coming of the Lord, not just Christmas, not just baby Jesus, but the return of Jesus Christ as our judge and as our redemption made perfect. So he says, in relation to that, Isaiah tells us that the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, bind up the brokenhearted, freedom for the captives, release from darkness from the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God. Vengeance as in like to set right the wrongs that many of us have faced or are looking at. And to comfort all who mourn, provide for those who grieve, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of the spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. The year of the Lord. But if we go to the next slide, I'm asking like, what? What good news to the poor? What bind up the brokenhearted? When have we seen that in our lives this year? Have we? Freedom for the captives, release from darkness for the prisoners, comfort for all those who mourn. What is this year of the Lord? You know, it's so funny that we like church has sometimes this bubble. We have all the right terms and we say the right things. And we say, yes, you know, praise the Lord, the peace of the Lord be with you and also with you. And then we go back out into our frazzled, harried lives. What is this year of the Lord? And the year of the Lord's favor is actually a very, very interesting thing. I was reading some commentaries online. The source of all lay preachers is the internet, of course. But it comes from Leviticus. For those of you who've never been to that part of your Bible, it's actually in the Old Testament, one of the first five books. If you've ever had the joy of reading Leviticus from beginning to end, it's a challenge and a very, very interesting thing to, and a very interesting exercise to go through. Leviticus 25, verse 8 to 12, this is where we get the year of the Lord's favor from. Count off seven Sabbath years. So seven Sabbath years means, you know how every seventh day is the Sabbath, right? So every, for us, Monday to Saturday is so-called work and get things done. Sunday is a holy day, the Sabbath. Actually, in ancient Israel, they actually practice it as well with years as well. So every seventh year, you get a rest, a year of rest, which is very, very interesting. You don't plant, you don't do certain things, and you allow captives to go free and all sorts of things. Now, seven times 7 years, so that seven Sabbath years amount to a period of 49 years. So every seventh year, seven times, equals 49. So the 49th year is a year of rest. All right? I know, math on a Sunday morning, tough. I know. Bear with me. We'll get there. Then have the trumpet sounded everywhere on the 10th day of the seventh month, on the Day of Atonement. Sound the trumpet throughout your land. Consecrate the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout the land to all its inhabitants. It shall be a jubilee for you. Each of you is to return to your family property and to your own clan. The 50th year shall be a jubilee for you. Do not sow and do not reap what grows of itself or harvest the untended vines. For it is a jubilee and it is to be holy for you. Eat only what is taken directly from the fields. This is where we get the idea or the concept of the year of the Lord's favor is the jubilee year, right? If you go to the next slide, the year of the Lord's favor actually has several things. It is not simply a release from labor, right, so that the people could rest. It was actually also very importantly about the year of the Lord's blessing and favor. You must remember, this is an agrarian society. These are farmers. They live, if you don't plant, if you don't water, you don't get food, right? So to not plant, water, and tend the ground, you're basically saying, okay, now what, right? So it was a time of the Lord's blessing and favor. It was a time when God wanted his people to rest from their own works and rely and trust in him to provide for their every need. Have you tried living a year without work? I have not. I don't know if I've got the courage to, but can you imagine that? That for the people of Israel, this is not just, oh, nice opinion or nice suggestion. It's actually a part of cultural life. It's a part of their religious mandate. It is a part of who they were. Every 50th year was comprised of a series of 7 times 7 sabbatical year cycles. So we'll go through, we've already been through that. And when the time came to celebrate the 50th year, it was ushered in by the blowing of the shofar. It's a trumpet from a ram's horn on the conclusion of the Day of Atonement. And then a whole additional year was set aside as belonging to the Lord. Main point, the 49th year, you've already rested for 1 year. And then comes the 50th, you rest an additional year after that. The Lord is very interesting. When he wants us to rest, it is not just to, you know, just melt into our couches. But that very act of rest that some of us, especially perhaps in our frantic society, cannot handle or cannot deal with, is that it is ultimately about trusting and relying on God and saying that he will provide. Can you imagine then not working for 2 years? Because that's essentially what happened. The year of Jubilee, right? And that's the year of the Lord's favor. If we go to the next slide, and that's where we come to John, right? John, therefore, was a man who was sent by God, and he himself was not the light, and we've already read all this. But basically, a few points. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness of the light, right? I am not the Messiah. I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord. The hope of the year of Jubilee, the final, that huge 50th year of rest that everyone could look forward to, John was a herald for that. He actually came and talked about that. He actually came to prepare the way of the Lord, Jesus, who would come and actually bring, usher in that year of the Lord. In the next slide, it is about, he was a witness, and this is some of the key things I just want you to take away in terms of meditation. John himself was a witness. He made it very clear. He's not Jesus. He's not here to do the work of Jesus. He was here to point the way to Jesus, to prepare the way for Jesus. And that is something about the work of witnessing that I think sometimes you and I in church forget. Sometimes even Christians think that they are God. I have a quote that I like very much. Anne Lamott says, "The only difference between you and God, or us and God, is that God doesn't think he's you." Right? Sometimes that's the only difference. So the work of our witness, and that's something that we may have forgotten in our daily Christianity, is, next slide, please. The work of our witness, the gospel writer John actually wanted to make it clear that John is not any type of messianic figure. He was not a prophet. He was not anything. He was just the guy who held the sign that says, "Boing, that's Jesus," right? The whole purpose of John was to be a sign and witness to point to someone else. And this was a very interesting question that I found in one of the commentaries. What does it mean for us to actually declare that we are not the Christ? Often we think of the other way, right? We are like Jesus. We are the only Jesus that some people will ever see. But what does it mean if we flip it the other way around and say, for a change, actually we are not Jesus. We are his witnesses, right? One implication is that we as individuals and congregations cannot save people. It is not our job to save people in that sense. That's the Lord's work. Our job is to point to his salvation. So if we are to fulfill our proper role of not being the Christ, we need to be voices and ears and arms and legs that point to Christ. I think that's one of the first distinctions I realized in reading about John the Baptist and preparing the way of the Lord. We sometimes come from church traditions where we act as though, for in a very, perhaps too extreme way, God depends on us, to the point that we have forgotten that he is the one who acts first, that it is his movement in this world that we are participating in, and that we are not doing God a favor. We are joining in the work that he is doing, whether or not you and I want to participate in it. And John, as a witness, actually points to that. He says, "I'm not the Messiah, but it is important that I point to the Messiah." The next slide. Oh, awesome. The message of our witness. We have a message. We are here to share one thing. And the message of our witness is, boink. Awesome. One day we will have that clicker. It's ironic. Our message is actually all those things that we don't hear in this world. Good news for the poor. The binding of the broken, binding up of the brokenhearted. The freedom for the captives. The release from darkness for the prisoners. Comfort for all who mourn. Against the backdrop of insanity that some of us see or perceive as in this world, from the macro stuff like economics, politics, down to slightly more micro stuff like office politics and personal economics. Against that backdrop, let us not forget that we have a message, and it is a message of hope. It is good news. There is healing. There is freedom. And above all, the third, the next slide, the strength of our witness. Where does our strength come from? If we go, next slide, please. I like this guy. His name is Philip Yancey. Some of you from the slightly been around there, bought the t-shirt kind of people, would probably have read his books like What's So Amazing About Grace, The Jesus I Never Knew. One of the books that I really liked about his was this book called Rumors of Another World. And it talked about how Christians need to live in a way with two realities, the reality that most people see and the reality that we are called to, the hope that we have, the reason that after Jesus came, we are able to live day by day. And for some people, they look at Christians and say like, oh, you're a bunch of airy-fairy people. You pray to the ceiling and you sing songs to enjoy yourselves and you huddle together to, you know, keep yourselves company. But at the end of the day, it's all airy-fairy stuff. It doesn't work. There's no substance, no tangibility to what you're doing. And so for some people, they say hope is wishful thinking. And in his book, Yancey actually mentioned that instead of wishful thinking, he'd sometimes rather think of it as thoughtful wishing. A careful consideration of the evidence or the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things unseen. Hebrews 11:1, faith. Some of us may have seen all sorts of horrible things this year. Some of us may have forgotten to hope. Some of us have been so dejected at the things that are going on around us that our eyes have turned not up, but to the ground, and we just perhaps are overwhelmed. Perhaps there's this Advent season, as we think about Jesus, his coming again, and we look forward to the celebration of Christmas with our families, the hope that we have, the thoughtful wishing, perhaps there's space in our lives for that, or that we should make consciously make space for that thoughtful wishing in our lives. If in the next slide, it is about marching to the beat of a different drum. This is a theme that has really resonated with me very much. Before I started my new job, I actually took 2 months off to decompress from the craziness of my previous job. And it was a very interesting learning experience. I became the stay-at-home dad, right? So I'm you know, ferrying my kids to work and school. See? Oh, that's right, school. But it feels like work to me. That's why. No, but sending kids to school, bringing them back, making them eat lunch, making sure they go to nap, and then sleeping, you know, all that stuff. It was very interesting for me because it was truly, in a very real and practical way, marching to the beat of a different drum, where all my other friends were telling me about, whatever work they're doing and whatever things. And I'm like, yeah, I had a great day today. You know, my kids actually went to sleep on time and I had time to go to the toilet and all sorts of stuff. That was when I started thinking about this theme that started resonating in my head, marching to the beat of a different drum. And then I started work in my crazy place, right? And working in this new environment, it's an American company where everything is measured. God knows how they measure everything, but they do. And it was very strange to see the behaviors there. Like from my cozy, okay, two rambunctious boys at home kind of scenario, and then going back into the workplace and thinking very hard to myself, like, gosh, I'd really rather be home right now and, you know, spending time with the kids. And I have to consciously remember that, you know what, I really need to clock off on time as best as I can and go home because the kids are growing up. They will never be this age again, and all these thoughts. And then I see my other very ambitious colleagues around me, and they're like plugging in the hours. They're really working hard. You know, emails are flying back and forth. And I suddenly think to myself, gosh, I feel so out of place. I feel so out of place because I feel like I'm marching to the beat of a different drummer. I hope you feel that. I hope that when you think of the way that we're walking in this world, as we go back to work, as you go back to whatever it is you're doing, back to your daily lives, I hope you sense that. I hope you feel this tug of an other world that brings you hope. Because ultimately what that tug means is that you and I are privy, are made aware that this world is not the way it should be. That there is a better way. There is a much better joy. There is a better way to live. And this hope that we have, this thing that we live in our hearts, becomes our message, becomes the reason for our existence here, becomes the reason why we share together. And as you march to the beat of a different drummer, can I go to the next slide? You find that things are flipped around. You end up living a very reversed life. Suddenly, it is not that you need to take care of your big boss's ego. It is that colleague who is quiet on the side and eats lunch by themselves that you really want to spend time with. That the most important person's call that I have learned, and I'm very struggling to maintain and remember this, is it's not my email or SMS from the company, but it is actually when one of my boys actually says to me, "Hey, Daddy, look at me." That's a recurring refrain right now. Look at me, you know. And I just remember stopping that one day and thinking, gosh, that is the most important request that he's making of me. And if I don't capture that, I will lose it. I will lose witnessing something that, you know, one of my children are going to be very joyful in showing off, even if it's as simple as jumping off the bed and hopefully not cracking their skull open. But that's finding life reversed, finding life upside down, marching to the beat of a different drum, a hope that we are called to, the year of the Lord's favor, when the world tells us that it is time to work like a dog and forget all other things. The Lord says, the year of the Lord's favor means you cease what your frantic activities are going on with, and you take that time to rest. And you take that time not just to rest, but to trust, because I will provide. I like this video that was coming around on Facebook, and I thought it was a perfect example of how we flip things around, and a really great example. I just wanted to show this with you to just encapsulate most of the thoughts that have gone through my head in sharing this meditation. Bessan, would you mind playing it for me? I don't know how many of you have seen this, but do enjoy it.
Good times for a change. See the luck I've had. Could make a good man turn bad. So for once in my life, let me get what I need. Lord knows it would be the first time.
Forgive me that it's a TVC, but I liked it very much because I was anticipating some really... Kent, Bess, thanks. I was anticipating some sort of punchline, but I was not prepared for that punchline. It was such a refreshing change to see all the frantic activities of waiting that we're used to seeing when it comes to children and Christmas. You know, the kid was like tapping his feet, waiting to just will that time moves faster. And it was all because he had a gift that he couldn't wait to give to his parents. He jumped off his bed and ignored all his other presents. And I hope that as we go through Christmas, as we go through the Advent season, as we think about all the things that we are going through in church and in life, I hope that you and I will think about that. We'll think that all the frantic activities that we sometimes have to do, all the requirements and things that we have committed to, that it actually leads to the hope that we have, that it flips people on their head, that people will not look at us going crazy at work because we are here to chase the same rat race dream as others, but perhaps the big paycheck that we're trying to earn actually allows us to give more to others, that the positions that we find ourselves in, that we tend to, if we're pursuing ambition and reaching to higher levels of authority, that it is not just for that end, or not just to be king of the hill, or queen of the hill, sorry, brothers and sisters, But it is so that we are put ourselves in a position that we are there for such a time as this, like Queen Esther, that we flip things on their head. Because ultimately we are, the next slide, Bess, we are a people of hope. We hope. We proactively, positively look forward to something better. And we are a people of hope, and that is why, in the next slide, we can always rejoice, that we can always pray, and we give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Jesus Christ. Do not quench the spirit, do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good, reject every kind of evil. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And this was the kicker for me. In everything I've been reading and all that, and even in our discussions among those who have been asked to do preaching, we realize that every portion of Scripture has that element of grace that points us back to the strength that we find. The one who calls us to hope, the one who calls us to this different life, is faithful. And he is the one who will do it. He is the one who will do it. So we rest in that hope. We rest in that hope, and I pray that you and I, as we go through the motions leading up to Christmas, and it's very funny, Christians are the most busy, most frantic people during Christmas. Everybody else is just enjoying their holiday season. We're like, oh, you know, caroling here, church there, and parties here and there and all that. I hope that in the midst of all of that, you and I will make space for thoughtful wishing. That you and I will make space to remember the hope in Christ that we have. That he comes again and fulfills, makes complete the joy that we have been looking forward to. He will put sight to the voice that we have embraced. And because of that, we can walk faithful with him as he is faithful with us. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, as we just take this time to pause, as we take this time to decompress in the midst of service activity, for some of us who are playing, some of us who are sharing the word, some of us who are doing sound, some of us who are just trying to concentrate, all these things, Lord, we take time to decompress. Remind us of hope, Lord, this season. Help us make space for hope to bloom and to grow. Help us, Lord, be those witnesses for hope, that people would look at us, Lord, and wonder why, when things look so bad, or when things are so frantic in one direction, we exhibit a different way. We point to a different direction. We march to the beat of a different drummer. And so, Lord, as we just end this time from hearing from you, I pray ultimately, O Lord, that you will move in our hearts, that the seed of the word of God that has been planted, Lord, help us ensure that it is kept in good ground, so that each and every day as we walk towards you and walk with you, Lord, this seed will grow and bear good harvest. We thank you, Lord, for this time. As we move on to the rest of the service, O Lord, we pray that your holy presence continues to linger with us in each and every part of what we do. We thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.